Over a period of time, Cassie and Austin have come to know and to love each other. Today they've asked, along with their parents and their families, all of you to join with them as they commit their lives to each other in marriage. Repeating words in front of a church full of people can seem intimidating at times, but often it's easier to say them here than it is to live out those words day after day. The promises that you're going to make to each other today must be renewed and redecided tomorrow and each day after that. This time, I want to ask, who gives Cassie to be the bride of Austin?
We're thinking. Your mother and I.
Okay. I will say this, Ken, he almost brought a football out here and tossed it to his dad, but he changed his mind at the last second. Let's pray together. Father, this is a special occasion that it's a privilege for all of us to be together with you in this place that's dedicated as a place for people in this community to come and worship together as we get to see this couple unite their lives in marriage. I pray that you will bless them. I pray that the commitments and promises they make, that you will just write them on their hearts and their minds and help them to be strong, and that you will fill their lives with love and joy. And I pray that you would pour out the same thing on their parents and their families and their friends. And Father, I just pray that you will watch over them and keep them healthy, physically, spiritually, and mentally all the days of their lives. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Real love is something, it's beyond the warmth and glow of the excitement and romance of just simply being deeply in love and feeling in love like the first time that you figured out that you really liked each other. And I don't know who decided that first, if there anyone had to, you know, work on the other one a little bit more, how that went. But there comes a point in time, there did for you, that you realized that, you know, you really didn't want to spend your life without the person who is standing here with you today. And so that love that you have and the feelings that you have, they're going to enable you today to make commitments. You're going to make commitments in your heart and in your mind. There will be days when your mind may grow weak and your heart will be what has to carry you through. And there may be days when your heart grows weak But your mind carries you through as you remember the commitments that you made, the promises that you've made. And to all of you that are here, you are a part of this. And so you have a responsibility too. You have the responsibility to always pray for Cassie and Austin. And to remember when you see them, to remember them in prayer. When Kenny and Heather married, I think I remind you, they will never mind. I just been around Austin, what little I have, and knowing Cassie, if you want to slip them some money to go out and eat, or you want to take them somewhere, the best man in our wedding paid for most of our wedding, so you may want to talk a little there. I picked a banker for mine, but oftentimes he and other people have just given us, they'd normally give it to Colleen and say, take me out to eat, and go do something with that, but there's a big role for all of you to play. And if they're going through good times, be there to celebrate with them. If they're going through difficult times, be there to encourage them and help them get through that. And always find yourselves pushing them together and never pulling them apart. And so that's a commitment that I ask all of you that have gathered with us today to make and to be a part of this ceremony. In John chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, if you read that in your Bibles, you see that Jesus began his public ministry in Galilee, and he performed a miracle by turning water into wine at a wedding in Cana of Galilee when the wine had run out. And so Jesus was a part of weddings from the very beginning, and he's a part of the wedding here. You may not see him, but he is here. He's very present because all of us who are believers, he lives within our hearts and lives. So, and I know for the two of you, he's here. He's in your heart, and he's present. In Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through 24, the Bible talks about being one flesh, and it's a unique oneness between a husband and wife. And the passage there, it says, so the Lord caused, God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. While the man slept, the Lord took out of one of the man's ribs and closed up the opening. Then the Lord God made a woman from that rib, and he brought her to the man. Wow, the man said. No, really, it says, at last the man exclaimed, this one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken from man. And it says this explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 21 through 33, the Bible also talks about a mutual submission where we put the best interest of our spouse first. And we talked about that as we walked through and worked through counseling and talked about the different roles that we have in our relationships. The Bible says, it says, and further, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is the head of his wife as Christ is head of the church. He's the Savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. I think that's a lot easier than what God then says to the husband. For husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. It's unique that the Bible didn't say that the wife had to love her husband. It talks about submitting. She should, but the Bible says that a husband has to love his wife like Christ loved the church, and Christ gave his life for the church. And I've always thought that if a husband fulfills that role anywhere near the capacity that the Bible speaks of, that they'll have a wonderful relationship, and there will never be an issue at people getting hung up about where the Bible talks about submission, because it is a submitting of one to another for what's best for the other person. And I understand that already, that from some of our premarital counseling, that Cassie has reminded you of a few of those things they said in a card game or something you were playing the other night. So you're going to have a fun life. I've had a fun one, and I think you're going to have a fun one. And that's going to be neat. In 1 Corinthians 13, the Bible talks about love. It says, if I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains but didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it, but if I didn't have love for others, I would have gained nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. That's a really neat picture of love. And that's what your love for each other is supposed to be. You know, Cassie, I've had a chance over years to watch your family and to know your family, to golf with your dad, which is an experience. But to just, from a distance, watch you guys grow up and stuff. I've had the privilege last night to get to spend time with your family, Austin. I've heard about your family, and I've heard a lot about you and stuff, but to see the love and the unique relationship that your family has and their love for you, I didn't know your dad was a poet until last night, but the things that he shared in there, having grown up in a family where athletics was very important, I understand a lot of things that have bound your family together, and I've never been big on horses. One ran down the side of a mountain with me on it one time, and I've always been nervous about that, but so I'm going to let you enjoy that part. But just to watch your family, and I think all of us that got to be together, it's a neat thing to watch the two families. And you're both blessed, and you're very, very blessed to have them. And I'm thankful for it because they have sought to bring you up in the way of the Lord. And they've wanted you to know the Lord, and they want you to be a significant part of your life. And so they bring all that together, and they've put it in you. And now you get to stand before God together to become a husband and wife. At this time, we're going to exchange commitments. And I'm going to start with you, Austin. So if you'll look at Cassie and repeat these, just say, be prepared to respond. Austin, do you promise to take Cassie to be your wife? Will you love her as Christ loves the church? Will you commit yourself to her happiness? And will you promise to love, honor, trust, and take care of her in sickness and in health, in adversity and in prosperity, and be true and loyal to her as long as you both shall live? Cassie, would you look at Austin and be prepared to respond? Do you promise to take Austin to be your husband? Will you commit yourself to him? Will you promise to love, honor, trust, and take care of him in sickness and in health, in adversity and in prosperity, and be true and loyal to him so long as you both shall live?
I will.
Now, could I have the rings at this time? Okay, boy, I didn't know football. I know college players. I've heard about corruption in athletics, but tell you what, you got some bling. You got any more bling? Well, you knew this was coming. Which one do you want? I'm going to give you all of them. Hold on to that just a minute and put that in your pocket. Last year, we couldn't get out the toy sucker ring. I remember that. It wouldn't come out. So that's what I say. I've noticed between these two families, there's going to be a lot of fun. You know, you both have genetic makeup from your family, so it'll be fun. You have that ring, and I want everyone to look. If you look at this ring, it's a continuous circle. There's really, you can't tell there's a beginning or an end. And for you, that's the way your love is supposed to be. It should become so that you can't imagine ever not knowing each other. You can't imagine that there was ever a time that you didn't love each other, and you couldn't imagine a time that you would not, and that you wouldn't be together, and that you'd love each other. And this ring will always be a daily reminder to both of you of that. So, at this time, Austin, I'm going to ask if you will place the ring on Cassie's finger and repeat after me. Cassie, this ring I give as a symbol.
Cassie, this ring I give as a symbol.
And token of my love for you.
And token of my love for you.
With this ring I pledge.
With this ring I pledge.
My life and my love.
My life and my love.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father,
the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
The Son and the Holy Spirit.
Cassie, will you take this ring and place it on Austin's finger and repeat after me? Austin, this ring I give as a symbol.
Austin, this ring I give as a symbol.
and token of my love for you.
In token of my love for you.
With this ring I pledge.
With this ring I pledge.
My life and my love.
My life and my love.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son and the Holy Spirit.
The Son and the Holy Spirit.
Now will you both repeat after me? Entreat me not to leave you.
Entreat me not to leave you.
Entreat me not to leave you.
Or to return from following you.
Or to return from following you.
For where you go, I will go.
From where you go, I will go.
And where you lodge, I will lodge.
And where you lodge, I will lodge.
Your people shall be my people.
Your people shall be my people.
And your God, my God.
And your God, my God.
Okay, at this time, you'll do the unity sing. If you look at this, you can still see, and you had a lot of fun doing that, and that's the way marriage should really be. You should have a lot of fun all the time, but it would be basically impossible to separate those back out and get each color back into its own jar, and that's really what God has done today. He has tied your lives together in such a way that they're one. Now, you still, just as you can see the separate colors, you still bring your own personality, your own uniqueness, and that'll always be there, and you should never want to take that away from each other or squelch that, but this is always going to be a reminder of the blending of your lives today in the Lord's presence. Since Cassie and Austin have made these commitments before God in this assembly, by the authority invested in me, I declare that you are husband and wife. You're no longer two independent persons, but one, just as is represented in the sand. You're one in love, interest, destiny, and life. Austin, you may now claim your bride with a kiss. I heard people from Texas knew how to state claims. You did it well. Okay, if you'll turn around and face all the people that are gathered with us today, it is now my pleasure to present to you, for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Austin Smithy. And following as they recess out of the church, they would like to invite you, along with their families, to join them in the church parlor for a reception. God bless you.
Dear God.